y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy, folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden he break off in a song something like this.
Turn your Bibles with me, if you will, to the book of Jeremiah. The chapter is 29, and the verse is number 11. Chapter 29 and verse number 11. And you have it to say amen.
Amen.
Jeremiah says something that is powerful. Jeremiah says something that if you're not careful, you'll read right over it and miss who he's talking about. Jeremiah says, essentially, that he is questioning and wondering what God is doing, that in his time, his day, as he is facing bondage, slavery, not because he did anything wrong. In fact, historically, Jeremiah, known as the weeping prophet, the weeping preacher, is confused and perplexed and befuddled by the fact that the house of Judah, the children of Israel, have turned their back on God.
Lord have mercy.
Have refused to hear the word of God. And that he has preached constantly to tell them to turn back to God.
Yes, sir.
And God has sent him a message. And God says a message to him. He says that not only will Israel go into bondage, but you're going to go into bondage with them. Perhaps God knew that when we're in bondage, we still need the word of God. Perhaps God knew that when times are really rough, when people will turn their back on God, is when they need the man of God in the middle of the crisis, of the context of their crisis. It was not time to walk away from God, but it was a time to come to God. And so Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, is crying. He is upset because nobody wanted to go into bondage. Well, not only into bondage, but under the worst bondage that you could be under. And that was under Babylonian rule.
Yeah.
Under an insane king. Jeremiah knows that God is not playing. And then remember this, that while Jeremiah is penning this information, there are preachers who are around Jeremiah who are saying just the opposite. They are saying that God is not going to put too much on you. That God's not going to put you in bondage.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know about you, but what message do you want to hear? Do you want to hear Jeremiah tell you that if we don't straighten up, God's going to send us into bondage? Or do you want to hear that Johnny come lately, preacher come and tell you everything is going to be all right? The people were upset with Jeremiah because Jeremiah's message was not as warm and friendly and cuddly as the false preachers. His message was so friendly. It was much like Joel Osteen. It was so friendly and kind. Not a word against sin and just live and let the good times roll. But Jeremiah says, no, if we don't stop this stuff, we're all going into bondage, and I'm going into bondage too.
Preacher.
Yes. So Jeremiah now confused and Jeremiah upset because he has to go into a hostile environment. He has to be shackled and chained. He has to be a slave like everybody else. He has to stand there and still tell them that God has a plan. So Jeremiah writes a letter. He writes a response that God has to him in his sadness. And I want to ask for a minute, have you ever felt sad and despondent? Have you ever looked around and thought to yourself, God, what are you doing? Have you ever looked around and it seemed like everything around you is going straight to hell in a handbasket,
well,
and there's nothing you can do about it? Have you ever felt like that everything is out of control? Have you ever felt like just killing yourself sometime? Have you felt like just killing somebody?
Well,
sometimes y'all ought to say it. There have been times in my life when stuff is going bad that I'm looking for somebody to fist fight because I'm so frustrated.
Man.
Then these subtle words start to ease out from the scriptures. And listen to these words. For I know my thoughts towards you. Look at your neighbor and say, God knows.
God knows.
I don't care what you're going through. God says to Jeremiah, I know. Not man, not somebody else who don't have any power. But God says to John, I know what I'm doing. You're going through something right now and you don't know what to do. God says, I know what I'm doing.
Man.
I got a plan. God, I say amen. God said, I got a plan. You're sitting here saying, what in the world is your plan? God said, I got a plan. What plan? This don't look like a plan. We sit here in the school. People are leaving. People are turning their back. People are lying, backstabbing. All kind of treachery is going on. What kind of plan do you have, Lord? Because I got a plan. Uptown Church of Christ, guess what this morning? God's got a plan. Somebody had a shout amen.
Man.
Whenever you walk in the parking lot and don't see but 10 people, you ought to say, God's got a plan. He's
yes.
got a plan in place. Not Brother Hamilton will have a plan. God has a plan. And God said, I know what I'm doing. Listen to verse 20, verse 11. He said, look at verse 11. He said, listen, I know my thoughts toward you. Thoughts of peace. I got a plan, and my plan, I'm going to define it for you. I have a plan. It's a plan of peace and not evil. I'm not planning to hurt you, but I'm planning to move you to another level you would have never got to unless you went through the plan. Y'all still can't see the text, can you? I'm going to stay in this text. This is good stuff. I love this verse right here. So Jeremiah, looking at God as he praying. And God's revealing in his spirit. And God said in his spirit, Jeremiah, I got a plan. The thoughts of peace, not evil towards you. But God, I'm broke. I don't know what we're going to do for food. I got a plan of peace. But the only way I'm going to get you where I need to get you through is that I'm going to have to allow you to go through this process. Because without the process, there is no promotion.
Man.
I've got to, brother, what kind of process? God's plan for Israel in this text was a 70-year plan. Through four kings, through Cyrus, through Darius, beginning with Josiah, three minor rulers came in place, and then crazy Nebuchadnezzar. And God's plan was that he was going to allow Nebuchadnezzar, his family members, to rule over you, to put you in bondage, to allow you to see what a God is not, so you can appreciate what a God is.
Man, yes, sir.
Oh, y'all ought to say amen. Sometimes God has to let the church go through hell so you can see what a church is not.
Man.
So you can appreciate what a church is.
Yes.
Sometimes God has to let you have a preacher that ain't worth two bags of sugar.
Uh-huh.
So you can learn to appreciate a preacher who can stand flat foot and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Preach, preach.
Well, how you know you lying, bro? How you know? But Proverbs writer said in Psalms, Proverbs 19 and verse number 21, many are the plans of a man's heart. He said, but it's the Lord's purpose that will and shall be done. What you mean? You may have all kind of plans in your life. You may think you got everything figured out. But God said, I got a plan and a purpose. And what my purpose shall be done. You might not like my plan. I may not tell you my plan. But you can rest assured, my plan is foolproof. I'm not going to tell you, because if you knew my plan, you'd mess my plan up. Y'all need some Bible here, don't you? All right, back to the Bible. I go for Corinthians chapter 2, about the 25th verse. He said, now listen, he said, have the princes of this world knew the plan, In fact, he said in verse number one, come on into the house of God. Come on in, praise God. Come on in. He said, listen, he said, we speak the mysteries of God in wisdom. We speak the mysteries of God, even the hidden wisdom of God. And we speak this thing which none of the world knew, which God preordained before the foundation of the world.
Preach.
Then he says that none of us knew, had the devil knew, that by crucifying Christ, it was going to save the world.
Well, wasn't done.
The devil would have never used men to crucify Christ.
Man.
Y'all all right?
Yes, sir.
If you don't connect to anything else, connect to this. If you knew, if you could see the cross that God has for you, you would never pick the cross up. Amen. If you could see into tomorrow and see that in order to go from the pit to the palace, that you're going to have to be lied on, that you're going to have to be sold out, that you're going to have to go to jail, that you're going to have to be accused of rape, that you're going to have to be somebody else's slave in order to get from the pit to the palace, you would never ever took a step toward the palace.
Great.
Joseph didn't know the plan. That plan was a 13-year plan. Oh yeah, you read it all through your Bible about Joseph going from the pit to the palace. That was 13 years of that man's life in which he went through hell, and God never revealed the plan. Some of you have been going through stuff forever and a day. Some of you have been on the street. Some of you have been catching hell. Some of you have been in the face of death. Some of you are facing loss. You want to know the plan. God says, I can't show you the plan. Because if I show you the plan, you'll get outside of my purpose.
Man, man.
Y'all all right?
Yes, sir.
So I can't show you the plan. But I need you to trust me. That I'm the man. No, I'm God all by myself. I need you to say, I don't know what he's doing. Look at your neighbors. I don't know what you're doing, God. But I trust you, Lord. I don't know what he got, but I trust the plan. Just stick with the plan. All right. Amen. Walls in hell. All right. So we got the plan. Anybody got the plan? Y'all got Proverbs 19:21? Amen. Y'all got the Proverbs 19:21? You got Jeremiah 29, verse number 11?
Yes.
You should have had Romans chapter 8, verse number 28. For we know that all things work together for good that are called by him, according to his eternal purposes, that love him. We know you got to know right now that whatever you're going through, you might be going through financial hardship. You might be going through spiritual hardship. You might be going through the loss of a loved one. You might be going through a family disrupted. You might be going through everything all the time. You might have health problems. But whatever you're going through, you got to look and you got to shout. Now we know that all things work together for good according to God's divine plan and purpose. Who love him, who is called by the gospel of Jesus Christ. You got to shout sometimes. It's going to work out in my life. They thought you were down. They thought you were out. They were laughing. They were celebrating. But you kept saying, we know everything's going to be all right. Because I serve a God that sits high and looks low. Run your mouth if you will. But God's only setting me up for my comeback. You ought to shout. I know it's going to work out right now. I'm just talking to five people who've been on the verge of suicide. Who've been on the verge of giving up. Who've been on the verge of turning their back on God. But you're stuck with the plan. You could have lost your mind. You could have been talking to yourself. We're crazy. You could have developed schizophrenia. But you shouted. We know all things will work out for the good. According to his eternal purpose. Amen. All right, well, preacher, that's a hard plan. Because you told about a 7-year plan in the text. We know that some of them kings are found in Jeremiah chapter 52. He talked about one of the craziest kings they had. We know Nebuchadnezzar changed Daniel's name to Belshazzar. The word Baal is from the god Baal. Shazzar literally means protector. He changed Daniel's name from a spiritual name and said that Nebuchadnezzar's God, Baal, would protect him. That's the definition of his name. But I stopped by to tell you, whiskey not going to protect you. Meth not going to protect you. Good sex not going to protect you. Friends not going to protect you. Babylon not going to protect you. That stuff ain't going to protect you. The only thing going to protect you is the Lord. He is my shield, my high post, my confidant. He only can protect me. He only can protect you. But you got to remember, you got to stay with the plan. Now, it's not easy to stay with the plan because you're trying to figure stuff out while you're going in abundance yourself. And my brother helped me, can you help me? Listen, help you. He told me I'm going in with you. I got to try to help myself. Y'all ought to say amen. You know, brother Hamilton, we need you right now. I need you right now. I'm going through the same hell you're going through because you won't listen to God. First P, the plan. Second P, the purpose. What do you mean? God's plan. God's plan is never personal. It's often bigger than you. Y'all not say amen? When God designs a plan, it is on the one hand personally designed for you according to where you are spiritually. Secondary is not only for you. In order for Joseph to get what God had for him, and it had involved not only helping Joseph, but it helped his brothers as well. In other words, sometimes you're going through some stuff in your life, some pits, some imprisonment, some stuff in your life, because somebody needs to see you go through it so you're going to be in a position to help them when they get to it.
Man.
All right. In order for Joe to get to the palace, he had to raise the anger level and hostility level. Now watch what, I want to show you this very quickly. Joseph didn't do much to go to the palace. All Joseph did is did what? He stuck with the what?
Word of God.
No, he stuck, what
stuck,
I'm preaching about?
Stuck with the plan.
He stuck with the plan. Joseph didn't beat nobody up. Joseph didn't cuss nobody out. Joseph didn't get mad. Joseph didn't turn his back. He had God wanted Joseph to do one thing, and that's to do what?
Stick with the plan.
Stick with the plan. Y'all better listen to him. I'm trying to help somebody over here. Joseph had to stick with the plan. So Joseph has a dream. He sees the plan. He gets up. He says, I got to tell y'all about the plan. All God showed him is that he was going to be risen up, but he didn't show him how far he was going to go down. He was risen up, and he didn't say how they're going to go down. He just saw the end, the outcome. God showed him the outcome. He didn't show what's in between all the hell he was about to go through. And all God wanted him to do is just stick with the plan. Ladies and gentlemen, sisters and brothers, let me tell you something. I'll tell you this very quickly. If you will learn to just stick with the plan and stop messing around in between the plan and the promise, you'll make it to the promise. As long as you keep running your mouth talking against God, when you're going through something, don't you speak against it. You need to shout. It's just part of the plan. If your husband leaves you tomorrow, it must have been part of the plan. If somebody backstabbed you, that's part of the plan. If your job puts you off work, that's part of the plan. If somebody lied on you, that's part of the plan. When somebody hurts you, that's part of the plan. You meet dirty, low down, roach, rattlesnake, reptiles type people, it's part of the plan. Stick with the plan. He sticks with the plan for 13 years. He is thrown into a pit, brought up out the pit. He is then put in as a prisoner or a servant, put in the house of Potiphar. Potiphar's wife, who is a hot nymphomaniac, sees him and wants him and walks up with her whole lying, devilish self. And when he refused, he stuck with the plan. He stuck with the plan. I can't do that. And he took off running. She lied on him, had him put in prison. He was falsely accused. He must have been black. He went down in the prison. He gained favor with the guards in the prison. He did his time like a man. He went in there crying, talking about they set me up. I was innocent. I didn't do it. They tried to hold a brother down. He just kept sticking with the plan. And wherever he went, he told people about God. He revealed dreams. He manifested wisdom of God. Gave the hidden things of God. He just stuck with the plan. And God lifted him up out of that prison. God brought him to the palace. He became the dream interpreter and governor of the enemy. And the very same people who sold him out and done him wrong were a part of the plan. He had to manipulate the brother's heart to hate the brother. He had to turn brother against brother. He had to turn people who were supposed to be his owner against him. He had to let the devil toy with him, but it couldn't kill him. God had to manipulate governments and systems and family systems and places in order for his will to be done. What you saying? Sometimes God got to manipulate some folk in your life to raise that attention to a level that move you to a spot that you'll go where you're supposed to go. Sometimes you're going through what you're going through because God had to change your boss's mind. To change your boss's mind, he had to flip his call for 3 times to make him look at himself. You should try to figure out what's happening, but God knows his plan. Lord have mercy. Sometimes God got to run folk off in order to bring folk in. You just need to keep
with the plan.
Stay with the plan. Well, preacher, show us the purpose. Genesis chapter 50 and verse number 20. You remember the Bible says? The Bible says that he finally sees his brother and he says, now listen, I'm not even mad at y'all. You ought to text your enemy right now and say, I'm not even mad at you. I'm not mad at you, he said, because you meant it for evil, but God made it good. Y'all ought to shout right now.
Yes.
There's a devil sitting in here right now that don't see nothing good come to the church. But I'm going to tell you something. You might mean evil by you, devil, but God will make it for good.
Amen. Yes.
Why is God going to make it for good? Does God bless Jeremiah? Does he bless Joseph to help them? Not them by themselves. In verse 20 it says that he might save much people. The reason you're not dead is because somebody's going to be saved through you.
Man.
The reason you wasn't captured in the prison is because God's going to use you at a later date. Y'all about to say amen.
Man.
It's not because you're bad. It's because God got something big for you to do. The reason that God don't strike you dead right now because you sit in the house of God and won't give him glory is because he's trying to save somebody else through you. And they need to see what silliness look like so they appreciate him.
Man.
Lord have mercy. Woo, thank you, Jesus. Huh. Well, y'all need some more proof, don't you? Okay, I'm glad y'all asked that question. God's purpose is bigger than the person. How do you know? Jeremiah, the Bible says in Jeremiah 1 and verse number 5, he says, before I knew you, Jeremiah, I formed you. Before my plan, Charles, my plan is so powerful. My plan is so powerful. You're not bad enough to undo my plan. Because before you were born, I knew you.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. When you were in your mother's womb,
yes,
I sanctified you. Y'all ought to say amen. Yeah, I set you aside. Now you're trying to figure out how is it that I mess up and do all this stuff, and yet God still has mercy and grace on me.
Uh-huh.
Before you messed up, God already set up the mess up to help for the makeup.
Amen.
Well, y'all ought to be shouting right now. You thought you were living for the devil, but it was part of the plan for you to go through what you were going through. And I'm going to show you the text. I don't care what you've done. God wants to do something powerful with you, but it's your choice to either stick with the plan and leave the purpose or stick with the plan and follow the purpose. It's I sanctified you, Jeremiah, to be a preacher for the nations. I've sanctified you to do something powerful and wonderful for the nation of Israel. Are y'all with me still?
Man.
Now watch this. Paul, Galatians 1, verse number 15. Paul, the Bible says, when it pleased the Lord, when I was in my mama's what?
Womb.
Before I was Paul, before I was Saul, when I was in the womb, God separated me.
Deep.
God sanctified me. Before I started killing Christians, God already had the plan for my life. Before I started dragging people out to church and running folk off and had fear in everybody's heart, God already had a plan for me. Before I got on the road to Damascus and was knocked down on my high horse, God already had touched my life. And see, that's why you got to be careful of talking about folk, because you don't know what God is doing in somebody's life. His purpose for Paul was to preach the gospel to a dying world of the Gentiles, which he was uniquely qualified to preach because he had knowledge on both sides of the table, educated and trained. But what are you saying? Well, with Joseph, he wanted to save people. With Jeremiah, he's saving people. With Paul, he's saving people. What's going on? God has a plan and a purpose. And if you stick with the plan, you too can be seen in the hall of fame of faith. You too can be lifted up when you're down and you're downtrodden. The Bible says that my soul, it depends, it calleth on the Lord, and whom I shall trust. God said, I will lift you up with my right hand. Psalms chapter 46, verse number 41. When you stick with the plan and the purpose, you give it the power of God. What's the power of God? There is no hole deep enough you can dig that God can't lift you up. All you got to do is learn to stick with the plan. You can't lie enough. You can't cuss enough. You can't steal enough. You can't cheat enough. You can't drink enough. You can't hate enough. You can't do bad enough that God's power can't reach you. For though a righteous man fall seven times, he shall be lifted up by the power of his right hand. Amen. Psalm 46, verse number 10. Be still and know that I am God. I shall be lifted up. I'm going to save you, but it's not about you. It's about me. I want to know I'm a God that can save anybody. I can lift anybody up. I shall be exalted amongst the heathen. I shall be exalted in the world. Psalm 41, verse number 10. Be still and know that I am God. I will lift you up. You shall be strengthened. Fear not, for you shall be strengthened. And I'll lift you up with my right hand. Why? Because I want the world to know, as bad as he was doing, I lifted him up, set his feet on solid ground, put a new song in his heart, set him on his way saying, glory, hallelujah, I shall not be moved. And if I did it for him, I can do it for you. God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he shall repent. If he said it, God will do it. Won't he do it, church, this morning? Won't he do it this morning? Won't he do it this morning? Won't God lift you up? He's not a man who should lie. If he said it, he'll do it. If he said it, he'll make it good. When it ain't no good, he'll make it good. You are leaving saying he has the power to do it. He has the power to make it good. You're talking to a God who has all power in his hand. And that's enough for me, church. That's enough for me. And I'm going to tell you something. When you let this message be heard all throughout San Diego, the devil is a lie. God showed me the Uptown Church of Christ in downtown San Diego. And I'm going to tell you something.